Well, okay. Other reasons for coming here, besides wanting to keep us from going out there, might be that we're somebody's colony. Maybe a penal colony. They dumped all the bad boys and girls here, and that's why we're so nasty to each other. Australia started from convicts, after all, and they take great pride in it, I found, which was kind of funny, but to each his own, I guess. Furthermore, the Earth happens to be the densest planet in the solar system. I don't mean the people, that's probably true too, but a cubic foot of Earth on the average weighs more than a cubic foot of any planet in the solar system. That means more heavy metals here. Things like gold, uranium, tungsten, rhenium, osmium. Weird stuff with very special properties. I mean, we didn't find out that uranium was useful for much until not too long ago. 100 years ago, major use was as yellow glaze on dining room table pottery. You know, a plate such as served dinner on. That's illegal now, but that's what it was used for then. So there are all kinds of weird things here that they might be mining and stealing. There are a lot of reports of unidentified submerged objects, USOs. A guy named Carl Feind has a whole book about those, F-E-I-N-D-T. Maybe they're stealing some of those diamonds, which are rather precious materials, that have been washed into the ocean from African rivers. Maybe they're stealing those nodules that are down there. Who knows? We don't know what all is valuable here. We do know we're being visited. We do know that they're paying particular attention to, well, nuclear-equipped missiles. Malmstrom Air Force Base, 10 missiles went offline one after the other. These have nuclear warheads on them, Minuteman missiles, way back in 67, I think it was, when there was a UFO sitting out over the gate. And there was a great deal of consternation. Our nuclear missiles are not supposed to go offline on their own, to say the least. Of course, the noisy negativists will tell you it was just a power failure. Bill Nye, the science guy whose purpose is to deny. No, probably just a power failure. You know, you can imagine somebody kicking the extension cord out of the wall, I guess. Yeah. The power supplies are cripply redundant. That isn't the only place where this kind of thing has happened. So they may be interested in making sure that we don't go out there and that we don't clobber each other, because they've been mining goodies, and that'll be hard to do if we make a terrible mess out of the planet. Okay. I don't know. In my book, Flying Saucers and Science, I think I give 22 reasons for coming to planet Earth. You know, honeymoon capital of this corner, the neighborhood. Why do people explore? Lots of different reasons. So we have to stand back and take a broad view of the picture here, not be single-minded. Like, you know, if you look what kind of vehicles we have, if you stand over a turnpike, you get a lot of models, and not all of them work the same. We got diesels, we got electric, we got hybrids. You know, it's complicated. So Earth is moving rapidly, and I started to say about the 10-ton blockbusters, that was 42. Being the kind of people we are, in 1945, we upped the ante. Instead of 10 tons of TNT, our first atomic bombs, roughly 15,000 tons of TNT. Well, that wasn't good enough. In 1952, we exploded our first fusion weapon, H-bomb, if you want to call it. That sounds much more innocent, if you will. That released the energy. It was named Mike, incidentally. Mike released the energy of 10 million tons of TNT. So in 10 years, we went from 10 tons to 15,000 tons to 10 million, and the Russians a few years later set off one that released the energy of 57 million tons of TNT. Now, I mention this not just to show that we're nasty guys, and overall, incidentally, we Earthlings have exploded 2,000 nuclear warheads, fortunately only two of them on cities. But the kicker here is that you can immediately go from your control of fission energy to nuclear submarines, 1956, the Nautilus, and now the nuclear-powered carriers that can operate for 18 years without refueling. Nuclear fusion, I worked on studies of fusion propulsion systems for deep space travel back in the early 60s. Every advancing civilization will want to know what its stars do to make their energy. We found that out, we figured it out in 1938. Not very long ago, when you figure the planet's, you know, 4.5 billion years old. So once you get to that point, then your neighbors are within reach. I get so sick of ancient academics and fossilized physicists, and you can't get here from there. Laws of physics. Laws of physics don't prevent us from getting anywhere. It's our own ineptness that prevents us from getting there. But if you use a fusion rocket, you can kick particles out the back end that have 10 million times as much energy per particle as they can get in a dumb old chemical rocket. 10 million times. And what's nice about fusion as opposed to fission in the aircraft carriers, submarines, fission nuclear rockets I worked on, the biggest one produced twice the power of Grand Coulee Dam in something that was less than 7 feet in diameter, which that's impressive. Fusion uses hydrogen and helium isotopes. It just so happens that the two most abundant substances in the universe, everywhere you go, you're going to find hydrogen and helium. Uranium, not very common. You got to go to one of these dense planets. It takes a lot of work to separate the isotopes and all that sort of stuff. So fusion, everybody will know how their star works, and then smart people will figure out how to use it for propulsion systems as opposed to just killing people. You know, if for no other reason, the people who make fusion devices want to have a market. Let's build some big fusion carriers, if you will. They're not launch vehicles. You launch and then light them up when they're in orbit around the Earth or moving out in space. So what I'm saying here is that if you start looking seriously at our neighborhood, you realize that there are plenty of good targets very close by. I get people saying, well, look how far the nearest galaxy is. I don't care about another galaxy. Andromeda is 2 million light years away. The place, I think, the only place we have a specific source for these things, two stars, Zeta 1 and Zeta 2 Reticuli, in the constellation of Reticulum. They're just down the street, 39 light years away. They're 9.3. This comes out of the Betty and Barney Hill abduction case in 1961. This weekend I was in New Hampshire to celebrate the 50th anniversary of that with Kathleen Martin. We've written a book, Captured. She's Betty Hill's niece. But Zeta 1 and Zeta 2 Reticuli are quite unique in the local neighborhood. And I say neighborhood. There are over 1,000 stars within 55 light years of here. You don't need to talk about millions of light years. And about 5% of those stars are similar to the sun and probably have planets. Well, these two sun-like stars are the closest to each other pair of stars in our local neighborhood, sun-like stars. They're only an eighth of a light year apart. That's 30 times closer to each other than the sun is to the next star over. We're out in the boonies. This guy's got next-door neighbors. Also, they're a billion years older than the sun. So they've had a good excuse for developing interstellar travel. There's a neighbor down the street, and plenty of time to do it. My rule is that technological progress comes from doing things differently in an unpredictable way. So I suspect they're a little ahead of us, you know, maybe only a million years, maybe only 1,000 years. Look back 1,000 and see where we've come, even if it's just 100, for goodness sakes. So the galaxy has a couple hundred billion stars. Nobody's counted them all, but there are plenty close by. I expect that there are civilizations all over the place. And the Kepler satellite, which is only looking at a tiny hunk of the sky, about the size of your fist held at arm's length, is detecting planets left, right, and center. Like I say, they expect that there are maybe eight billion Earth-like planets out there.
There's this arrogance, I think, that I guess to call it that we think we are the apex, but it's just not true. If you're open-minded and you really want to know what the facts are, it's hard to decipher what is real and what is not. What's the best way to use discernment when it comes to doing personal research?
Well, I think you got to consider the source. You got to consider the level of the referencing. For example, people are always asking me about Colonel Corso's book, The Day After Roswell. Now, he supposedly figured out how all kinds of new technology and slyly introduced it into industry. After 1960, mind you. Well, I did a lot of checking on Colonel Corso. You notice the book has no references And as a matter of fact, some of the things he took credit for, one of them, microcircuits, a guy won a Nobel Prize for work done 2 years before Corso was involved. So you got to do some checking. What are the facts? Corso claimed he was a member of the National Security Council. That's the highest level of advisory body to the president. Well, I checked with the Eisenhower Library. He was never a member and never attended a meeting. I sent a copy of that to the attorney for whom he had made a sworn statement that included that he was a member of the National Security Council. And the attorney showed him the note from the Eisenhower Library. Don't you think we ought to take that out? No. I mean, you know, what do you do? That's not scientific. It's not detective right, you know, gathering evidence. It's baloney.
There's an article that you wrote about Bob Lazar. He's another guy that was out there.
Yes.
Who was claiming to, I guess, have reverse engineered and rebuilt another craft, if I'm not mistaken.
Well, yeah, he figured out how they work, and he claimed to be a nuclear physicist. And unfortunately, MIT says he didn't go there, as he claimed. Caltech said he didn't go there. His high school said he finished in the bottom third of his class, which means he couldn't have been admitted to MIT. His element 115 scheme won't work. He said Los Alamos had 500 pounds of the stuff. Well, the half-life is less than a second. You can't gather 500 pounds of something and keep it for any length of time if the half-life is less than a second. He's a bright guy. You can buy nuclear equipment from him and United Nuclear in Michigan, but he wasn't telling the truth about his UFO experiences.
Well, and I think there's a lot of people out there that aren't. I once heard that sincerity isn't necessarily indicative of the truth. And so there's a lot of people who do a really great job at telling their story and telling what they believe to be the truth, but it just isn't always there. Other than going to stantonfriedman.com, is there anything else that you might be able to offer as far as ways of being able to contact or learn more?
Yeah. Join MUFON, M-U-F-O-N, Mutual UFO Network, which puts out a monthly magazine, the MUFON Journal. Last month, incidentally, they received over 1,000 reports of UFO sightings. So people say, nothing's happening. Oh, yes, it is. There's plenty going on. So that would be my first step. Check it out. Get the publication. I have a monthly column in the MUFON Journal. I've been doing that for, I don't know, 5, 6, 7 years. I don't know. But that's a good place to start. And you can join your local MUFON group. There are a few thousand members. And get involved if you want. You can become an investigator. There are certain procedures you have to follow and tests you have to take and all that. But that's the best place I know. And the thing is, you need a big gray basket. Not yes, not no, not black, not white, maybe. Don't reach a conclusion until you've asked the right questions and checked it out.
I can't tell you how appreciative I am. And it was a great opportunity to hear firsthand from somebody who is the real deal. And thanks for being with us.
You're very welcome.
Have a great day.
Bye-bye. Thank you.